Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session on the additional support for learning inquiry. And this is the second formal session we've had, which will consider how the Education Additional Support for Learning Scotland Act 2004 has been implemented and how it is working in practice 20 years on. Wow. We will focus on three themes throughout the inquiry: the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming, the impact of COVID-19 on additional support for learning, the use of remedies as set out in the Act. And today we're going to focus mainly on the second theme, but not specifically on that. We will probably stray into other areas as well. Can I welcome Susie Martin, the External Affairs Manager for the National Autistic Society in Scotland, Glenn Carter, Head of the Scotland Office, Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, Dina Aitken, Director of Development and External Affairs at the Salveson Mindroom Centre, and Irene Stove, Deputy Head Teacher and Committee Member of the Scottish Guidance Association. Welcome, all of you, and thank you for your written submissions you've provided ahead of this meeting. They've been extremely helpful. We're going to move straight to questions, and I've taken a convener privilege this morning, and I've got the first one, a bit of a scene setter. And it's really focusing in on COVID and the impact that it's had on our young people. So what do you think are the main impacts the pandemic's had on pupils with additional support needs for children, young people, and also their parents? And to what degree have these impacts been mitigated by the support schools and local authorities have in place since then? Who'd like to go first? That's a big scene setter. Glenn, can I come to you? Sorry, I caught your eye.
No problem. Okay, thank you. I think the pandemic has obviously had a very significant impact on children with additional support needs, and those impacts have been varied. One clearly has been, during the pandemic, the issue around access to services, where they struggled to get access to a range of different services. You know, our member speech and language therapists rapidly changed their way of doing business to offer virtual offers. They already had established good social media presence, so that was very helpful. However, many of them were redeployed to adult services, which reduced their capacity to provide services for children with additional support needs. And when the schools started to reopen, the access to schools were variable. So, interestingly, depending on the local relationship and whether they were seen as core members of the team, indicated as whether they got access to schools sooner rather than later. So clearly there was the access issue, but for children themselves, our members, our early years practitioners or teachers are saying that there has been a very significant impact on children. Primarily, the impact they've seen is the increase in complexity of needs that's presented to them because of the lack of early intervention and prevention. And we know that the majority, a very significant number of children with additional support needs have communication needs. And we know the really quality evidence for the alignment between communication and their attainment, their well-being, their attendance at schools, their behaviour and their future life chances. We're seeing an impact on all of those areas. And I suppose it speaks to the importance of being able to get in as early as possible to meet the needs of these children. But in summary, we're seeing an overwhelming increase in demand and an increase in complexity for these children.
Thanks, Glenn. And I know there's lots of members want to ask some specific questions around the speech and language therapy as we move throughout the session. Susie, what about yourself?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, convener. I'm just going to give a very, very brief introduction to our organisation for anybody who's not familiar with it. The National Autistic Society Scotland has been supporting autistic individuals and families for over 25 years. We have a range of support services, and we have some that are directly for autistic children and young people, including a programme of support that looks to support those children and young people who are not currently engaged in education. And the team either look to re-engage them in education, or where that's not possible, put measures in place to put them on the pathway to a positive destination. We also have a programme of support called Empower Up, which is for autistic young people to give them the tools and strategies to navigate the world around them, and a network of 16 branches across Scotland, many of which are run by autistic people and parents and carers, and a lot of them provide support directly to families as well. We also campaign alongside autistic people and their families. As I'm sure many of you know and will be familiar with our campaigns, we had the Not Included, Not Engaged, Not Involved campaign around education, which launched in 2018. And also we have an ongoing campaign for a commissioner for autistic people. I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity today and just say from the outset, I'm going to draw on a number of sources of evidence. Our report from our Not Included, Not Engaged, Not Involved campaign, our Left Stranded report, which was UK-wide, about the experiences of autistic people and families during COVID, and also a short survey that we did just before Christmas specifically for this inquiry, which garnered over 100 responses. In terms of the impact of COVID on autistic children and young people and on their education, I'd just like to say from the outset that the problems that we experience in Scotland with additional support for learning provision and the issues around the presumption to mainstream existed before the pandemic, and they persist today. The pandemic did not cause those problems, although it did no doubt exacerbate the existing problems within the system. And I think, you know, you heard that last week at your session, and you likely will have heard it at your participation session. So I just want to say that from the outset. Lockdown obviously significantly disrupted the lives of autistic people, in particular autistic children and young people and their families. Many of them used school as a coping mechanism. It provided routine, it provided structure. Where there was support provided, it provided much needed support for learning. When that was withdrawn, there was obviously a huge impact on those children and young people in terms of, you know, their learning and their education, but also their social life and their skills that they had learned at school. And there was an impact on the family unit as well. Our Left Stranded report found that 68% of families who responded said that their child or young person was anxious at the loss of routine, and 65% said their child or young person couldn't actually engage in online classes. So that is a really, really significant impact. But we also know that some children and young people had a different experience. Going to school can be a significant cause of anxiety and stress for many autistic children and young people for a variety of reasons. And that is largely down to, you know, a lack of support in schools. So when school was removed from their life, the need to go into school was removed from their life, that removed a big source of anxiety and stress for those children and young people. I'm not going to say that being at home learning online was better for those children and young people. For many of them, it would have still been extremely difficult. But certainly some will have found the online learning experience more positive because they didn't have the stress and anxiety
and I think
of going into
school. The members will drill into some of those themes later on, Susie. So
yeah.
If you, yeah.
Of course, just... yeah. So I just want to say that we cannot understate the importance of being in the school environments. And I think that when it comes to schools supporting children and young people back into school post-COVID, we called for transition plans at the time. Some schools did that really well. Others did not put transition plans in place. There are some autistic children and young people who are still not at school today because there wasn't the right support transitioning out of COVID back into the school environment. So there are some great examples of good practice where schools have mitigated the impacts and got children and young people back into school, but there are some who are still really, really struggling today and their families are still really struggling today.
Thank you. Dina, what about yourself?
A similar picture, I think, to what you've already heard. We support parents and carers of children and young people who are neurodivergent and the children and young people themselves. And we do some transition work in schools with children who are considering next steps after school as well. And I think it is true that these families were struggling pre-pandemic. Services were already scant for the families and they were struggling. But the pandemic has really put a sharp focus on the isolation and difficulties those families have been facing. And post-pandemic, I think what we can say is we've seen a surge in demand for our services. We're supporting three times as many families post-pandemic as we were in 2019. and the level of distress within those families is much deeper. The complexity of the issues that they're bringing to us are more complex. And I think one of the key issues that we're seeing among the young people, the impact of the pandemic, is the absence of transition. So there are children in upper primary school who missed that key transition within school from the play-based learning of primary 1-2 into the more structured learning primary 3-4-5, and they are struggling in upper primary school now to make up that difference. And then there are the adolescents in secondary school who missed the in-person transition from their primary school to the much larger secondary school. And one of the key issues for those children is around socialisation, and the levels of anxiety amongst those children are really quite extreme. We're supporting lots of families where the children are not in school at all, or they have very, very part-time timetables, maybe just a couple of hours of teaching. And we're finding that the children that are out of school, it's taking longer to help them to return to school, and they're out for longer periods, and these part-time timetables are persisting for longer periods as well. So I'm sorry, it's a bit of a bleak picture, but I think we are facing really quite a difficult period for all the schools and the families.
Thank you, Irene. Putting the spotlight on the issues is always what we're looking to try and do, so thank you for that. And I know a number of you have mentioned the Stay Home, Stay Lives and how the young people really took that to heart, and they're still finding that as a source of anxiety to come back. So I was wondering, Irene, if you could maybe comment on that, but also in your evidence that you've presented around keen to learn about the families aspect of it and the role of respite services, mm-hmm. which were stopped and in many cases haven't returned. So I was wondering if perhaps you can respond to that element of it. Thanks.
Yeah, we had, as guidance teachers, we had a lot of children who did take the message stay home literally, particularly our children with autism and anxiety, children who were having to isolate because of suppressed immune systems as well, or family members with suppressed immune systems, that would continue to cause them a level of anxiety. So across Scotland, as I'm sure you're all aware, attendance has dropped. We've got children who have not made it back to classes or whose attendance is incredibly low. We have children who are perhaps waiting for medical treatment and are taking time off before medical treatments because they don't want to catch something in schools. So that impacts on attendance, and all of these things impact on families because they're struggling to engage with schools and to support the young people back into school. I've had meetings, as have my colleagues, with parents who are really worried about the level of their child's anxiety, who have had to engage with mental health services that they wouldn't have had to engage with before the pandemic. And what we have seen in schools is that the pandemic has caused us to have an increase in children with additional support needs because of the levels of anxiety. Dinah had mentioned about dysregulation as well. We're seeing a lot of children with dysregulation linked to probably their stress and anxiety. Also, because of what Glenn was saying about the services not getting into schools to be able to support with communication. So the children weren't getting services during lockdown and then when lockdown was kind of lifted and we were back in school, but we had all the mitigations in place that meant it was really just school staff and core staff that were in school. So that meant that some children have had to wait quite a long time, and that's impacted on their communication needs, which then impacts on their anxiety and impacts on their ability to regulate. In schools, a lot of our members were engaged with the connected and compassionate communities to make sure that all staff were kind of trauma-informed and able to support young people. Education Scotland provided a lot of resources that schools tapped into to try and you know, redress some of the mental health needs. For parents, you know, coming back into school, you know, we're having parents' nights online as well, not building the same relationships. And as Dinah had said about transitions, our transitions for our most vulnerable young people normally are enhanced and go over a long period of time for them moving from primary to secondary. And, you know, some of these were online, which was the best we could do. Schools were trying different things. We had schools that were doing, you know, virtual tours. So someone was going in and taking a virtual tour of the school so that young people could see, but it's for young people with complex needs, it's just not enough. So I think a lot of parents, you know, the respite, you mentioned respite services, respite stopped, so it puts an immense pressure on families and impacts on their mental well-being as well. And respite, just from our experience, hasn't gone back to pre-pandemic levels.
And it was also in your evidence that spoke about how the respite, you know, when the young person goes to that facility, they've got a social network there as well.
Yeah.
So it's beneficial for them as well as their families.
That's right. Yeah. And it gives the family a break and time to spend with other children, but it has a huge role in keeping, you know, so a lot of children used to look forward to respite. I think there's still a level of anxiety with the young people that we see who are access and respite, you know, because they haven't had the same opportunities to be away from home, so it's just more daunting.
Yeah, thank you, Irene. Can I come now to Michelle Thompson, please, for some questions?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Irene, you've kind of led on to it, and I want to bring in the other members of the panel. I'm interested in emerging specifically, or the insights gained in the pandemic, how dysregulated behaviours became more apparent, how they increased, and to what extent, in your opinion, they may have become embedded, particularly in children in early years. So some more insights. And obviously, I know that there was a lot of information you gave in your evidence to this. It's a chance to put it on the record. So perhaps, Glenn, I could come to you first, and then you, Susie. Thank you.
Yeah, there's no doubt that we're seeing an increased number of children with behavioural difficulties, and in the context of children with communication needs, all behaviour is some form of communication. And we know that, you know, in terms of communication is part of who we are as humans, and that we long for connection. And if that connection is not there and the inability to communicate is not there, then we become distressed, we can become depressed and low, or behavioural issues come to the fore. So that's certainly what we are seeing, and children with communication difficulties are far more likely to have behavioural difficulties and are desperate to have their needs met, to express what their needs and wants. And that's where having speech and language therapists within educational establishments can really help, because we can support staff to understand these needs, to support children to express their needs and wants, and to get that connection that they so desperately want. So there's a real connection between communication and behaviour. And we know that if we manage to give those children a voice, that all settles down. They feel connected and they feel supported by those around them, and it's a really powerful tool to reduce the level of behaviour.
Thank you. Susie, do you want to come in? I know this is something that you reference in your...
Yeah, evidence. Thank you. Thank you, Michelle. Yeah. I would want to say that obviously we've heard from your evidence session last week, and I'm sure we'll hear at this session this week, that there's felt to be an increase in number of learners with additional support for learning needs. Autism is a lifelong disability. Some autistic people don't consider it a disability, they consider it an integral part of their identity. I would just, you know, say that if there are more autistic children and young people, that is as a result of more awareness of autism and people coming forward to seek a diagnosis and support for their experience, their autistic experience. I think without a doubt, you know, COVID-19 will have caused autistic children and young people a lot of anxiety and stress, which has probably resulted in dysregulation and certain behaviours. I think the removal and withdrawal of certain services certainly will have exacerbated that. For autistic children and young people, it's all about the support. If the support is there and the services are there, then they are likely to be able to really enjoy their school experience and, you know, enjoy socialising with their peers. But if the support isn't there, then yes, they will experience dysregulation, and they will potentially, they will potentially behave in such a way that others around them perceive that as challenging or problematic. And I would just agree with what Glenn said around communication. Communication, you know, is a key part of this, as well as other supports that need to be available, because autistic children, young people, part of the autistic experience can be difficulties with social communication. So being able to communicate well with your teachers and with your peers is a big part of being able to enjoy school, being able to enjoy socialising. So yes, COVID-19 will have resulted in more autistic children, young people, you know, feeling dysregulated, and all the behaviours that come with that.
But just picking up on the way I framed the question, many of you in your evidence have presented how it had led to more dysregulated behaviour, but I suppose I was interested not just the increase. Are there instances where you think that behaviour or issue has become embedded depending at the learning stage or age that the child is at, and therefore to put in place the mitigations to overcome that will be extremely difficult?
I think I would potentially defer to other colleagues about whether that has become embedded at a specific age or stage, and whether autistic children, young people, or others with additional support for learning needs are still experiencing that dysregulation as they get older, and certain behaviours as they get older. What I would say from our experience is that when families do receive the support that they need, then, you know, the autistic children, young people really do start to progress and do much better at school, at home. So for us, it's really about getting the support in place, and that's what families are fighting for. But I defer to other colleagues in health and social care.
I can see smiles as people obviously want to come in. Diana, you caught my eye there, and I can see Deborah, you're keen to get in, Irene as well.
Yes, thanks. Again, I'm not sure about commenting on whether this is something that has become embedded. I'd certainly want to use the same phrase that Glenn used, that all behaviour is communication. And we do, as an organisation, have success in supporting families and improving those situations, but it's very much a relationship-based approach and building up trust, and learning the communication needs of the particular individual. And that's quite labour-intensive work. It takes time. So there's not really a quick fix for some of these children. They do need intensive support in order to be able to manage better in the environment that they're in.
And Deborah, I know you haven't had the chance to contribute yet. Good morning.
Good morning, and sorry that I've joined you late. The other email slipped by that the time had changed, so I thought it was 10 o'clock. I think from our perspective, we support the whole spectrum of neurodivergence, you know, within families. And there is that direct link that our trainer, you know, within our training programme will highlight, that puberty. The stage of puberty quite often causes regression in behaviours throughout. So early puberty can be problematic, so that kind of period of late primary school and that transition into secondary school. So when puberty is kicking in, you know, in regression and behaviours, that can present as major difficulties within that transition onto high school, and that's where we see lots of behavioural situations occurring, and there seems to be that lack of understanding that there can be that behavioural regression during puberty.
Thank you. And Irene, I know you haven't had a chance to come in yet, but I'm going to lead off with my next question, and you may want to pick something up. So in the light of what we know now, or what we've got a strong sense of, what do you consider to be the key points of intervention post-pandemic, and where do they differ to what we might have thought pre-pandemic?
I was going to speak about how we actually sort of the whole online learning actually sort of increased issues for young people through communication, because we were basically asking children to communicate and engage with computers and social media as a way of communicating, and that has led in schools, our members have noticed a big increase in cyberbullying, and that leads of course to greater anxiety, stress, dysregulation. So I think the environment of children being at home as well, the lack of opportunity to learn social skills through play has, you know, caused an impact. Can you repeat the last bit of your question?
Yeah, I suppose I was interested in if we were able to capture what we now know with hindsight would have been the key intervention points, where we now know that it tipped into dysregulated behaviour, and what we think is the key intervention points, have we gained new insights? In other words, a positive from the pandemic. So, I mean, we knew before what the key points of intervention were. Are they still the same? Have they simply been exacerbated, or have we got any new insights? I suppose what I'm trying to get to.
COVID inquiry on steroids there, is it not?
I don't know if I'll answer it fully, Michelle, but I'm happy to give it a bash. I would just say that I'm not convinced that necessarily the intervention points are different per se. I'm happy to be corrected by other colleagues on the panel. Early intervention is key, and we always knew that. And I think when it comes to dysregulation and autistic children, young people struggling, it's largely because their needs have not been identified or overlooked. So it's always going to be about coming in at the earliest possible opportunity. And our programme of support for autistic children, young people not engaged in education, the main bit of feedback from the young people, because it used to be 12 to 16, was, this was fantastic, I wish I'd had this when I was at primary school. So we reduced the age from 12 to 10, so we now support 10 to 16 year olds, and that change happened just after COVID, and that means we can support people with that transition from primary to secondary. But I'm not convinced they're necessarily different. I'm not necessarily convinced that, unless others want to say otherwise, but I think it's always about early intervention, as early as possible.
Glenn, from your point of view.
Thanks, Michelle. I would agree, and that goes back to your previous question about the dysregulated behaviours being embedded. So I'm not sure I would use that term, but you're absolutely right that the earlier we get in, there isn't the harm that occurs, and therefore we can prevent some of those behaviours. And that's not to say further down the line we can still provide effective interventions to turn things around and support kids to have their voice heard, to learn, to make friends in education context. But in terms of your broader question there, I think the key points, I agree with Susie that they are still the same. It's still about early intervention, prevention. Something I observed, and I was leading a children's speech and language therapy service during the pandemic, was something I observed was that we'd done quite a big bit of transformational work, a whole system approach within our educational establishments. And where that was working extremely well, I noticed when therapists couldn't get into that placement, that work was still going on, if that makes sense. So there was still an element of sustainability within the placement, because we've been empowering educators, we've been developing the environment, they were effective at early intervention and identification, and that was beneficial for the kids when we're not getting access. So hopefully that gives you some sense of the learning, and the pandemic shone a light on that particular aspect.
Thank you
very much. And can I formally welcome Deborah Best, who's the Director of Differabled Scotland, to the committee this morning. Thank you very much. And can I now move to questions from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I think my questions are for the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, but happy to hear from anyone else as well. We've heard, and in your written evidence as well, the importance of communication and that's impact on attainment, behaviour, as a protective factor against mental health issues as well. In your evidence, you say that there's a marked increase in presentations since the start of the pandemic, and that demand is still high 3 years on. I was quite struck by the numbers in the written evidence, that there was over 6,000 children waiting, and that the average longest wait for initial contact and individualised therapy was over a year. So I have a number of questions. Has there been any easing of the pressure? Would be the first one. Also, with the average longest wait for initial contact and individualised therapy, is that 1 year that a child, over a year that a child is likely to wait, or is that 2 years, if that makes sense? Do they have the contact then for the individual treatment, they have to wait another year? Yep, so those initially, and then I'd be interested to hear the impact of those waits in terms of development. And I think in answering my colleague Michelle Thompson, you spoke about the importance of intervening and that we could catch up. But I think it would be helpful for the committee to understand what the impact may be for, I don't know, a three-year-old or a four-year-old or whatever age to wait for a year and then have the intervention.
Thanks,
so Ruth. A little bit in there.
Thanks, Ruth. there's been no doubt that there's been a very significant increase in demand. I think we're very fortunate in speech, language and communication to have high quality prevalence data. So we knew pre-pandemic, there was a brilliant report called Equity for All, which the Scottish Government commissioned. And that was the first time in the world that we were seen that we were able to scope out the needs of a country and their communication needs. And so that was about, they estimated 275,000 children with communication needs. Public Health Scotland have come out with a report citing a sharp increase for the health visitors, noticing communication as their highest concern. That is always their highest concern, but they notice a sharp increase, particularly around 2.5 year olds. And that's a key area for speech, spoken language development. And then finally, we did a survey with Early Years Scotland, where we surveyed all of their members, and 89% of them have seen an increase or a significant increase in the need, the numbers and the complexity of communication needs. And I can come back to the why in a minute if that's helpful, but to answer your question about waiting times, the demand has been very significant, and we did this freedom of information request to all health boards, local authorities and health and social care partnerships. You're right to say that the average longest wait is 1 year, 1 month for individual contact. Now, different services manage it differently. Sometimes that will mean they wait for initial contact, and sometimes that also means they're put on another wait for an individualised support if they need it. Now, not all children require individualised support, but some do. And you may ask whether that's a normal sort of wait, but in our FOI analysis, we were able to show that over the last 5 years, that has increased. So the average individualised, the contact for initial contact increased by 7.5 months, and the wait for individualised therapy, if they required it, increased by 10.5 months. Now, the reasons behind that are complex. Of course, we've got the increase in demand. We've got a poor supply of speech and language therapists in Scotland. We've only got 2 HEIs who train therapists. Currently, we've got vacancy rates of between 10 and 11%. And a really important thing that's come to the fore in recent times is that funding for speech and language therapy services is complex and extremely vulnerable to cuts. And we saw just last week with one local authority cutting 100% of its funding for speech and language therapy. Now, these are challenging financial times. I'm not blaming in this position, but what I am pointing out is that these are very difficult decisions, and they can potentially and will, I would suggest, significantly impact the future of our children. So to respond to your question about impact, for a child to wait that amount of time at that age is, in my view, unacceptable. Again, I'm not apportioning blame, but for adults to wait that long, that's bad enough, depending on what they're waiting for. But for children, that is a very significant amount of time, because the amount of development they do, particularly in the early years, and critically around 2, 3, 4 years, that is an extremely long time to wait, and has a very significant impact on their outcomes. And we know that to be true, and that's why we're expressing a concern about it. Does that help?
That does help. Thank you. So speaking about resource there and the fact that it straddles health and education, I won't ask, the convener's asking me to ask, but I'm not going to ask which local authority it is. But what do you think needs to change? Because actually children's services as a whole straddles health and education. So it seems that the obligations to support children should already be there, if you know what I mean. I struggle to understand how that can happen.
I agree, because in the end, these are not health children, these are not education mm-hmm. children, these are Scotland's children, so they're yeah. whole children. And in my view, and this has happened in some areas of Scotland, the one local area answers the question, what do children with communication needs require in order to be Shanari safe, healthy, achieving, mm-hmm. nurtured, etc.? And they answer that together as an integrated team, and then they pool resources to deliver on the answer to that question. Each area is different. You'll have remote challenges, you'll have inner city challenges, but that answer should drive the funding, if that makes sense, not the other way around. I have been working across Scotland with key partners, ADES, COSLA, AHP directors and speech language therapy leads, to come up with an answer to the question you've had around funding. I think we should have a partnership funding agreement between health and education. We are developing a consensus on the challenges. We're trying to get to the consensus on the solutions. But in my view, we should find a way to support these children's needs and not fight over who's paying for it, because this is too important for Scotland to wrestle with that. What I would suggest, though, is also at the moment there's no accountability for these types of outcomes around communication. There's no particular measures. So there is something potentially we could do in Scotland to provide an accountability to health boards and local authorities. And that could be, I would argue, a joint accountability, because it's so relevant to health and it's so relevant to education. I think that would help drive some of this change. But it is a complex issue. As a service lead, I've been talking about this for a very long time. I don't think the vulnerability around funding for speech and language therapy is different from some other areas, particularly different. And actually, I'm not seeing that vulnerability in other areas of the UK. So it is a concern for me, and we need to act quite urgently on that.
That's helpful. Just finally, if I may, I'm conscious that that committee members spent some time with children and young people and heard what was important to them. And one of the things that struck out for me was the thing about positive relationships and, you know, just how important and protective and empowering that is to have positive relationships. Obviously, communication is key to that. You spoke about a whole system approach and gave quite a helpful example of where that was built in, actually, all the staff or people around the child could pick up on those approaches. What needs to change for us to have a whole system approach? And is it the case that getting it right for children with communication challenges or difficulties actually is better for everybody? It's good for all children. It's not just about a specialist service, if that makes sense.
You're absolutely right. And so this is a whole system issue and everyone needs to be involved. It's everybody's responsibility. I think speech and language therapists are a core part of it, but there's so much more to that. And what needs to change? I think speech and language therapy and allied health professions as a whole in children's services have done a load of work to transform how they do business in terms of early intervention and prevention, and have bucked the trend, I would suggest, in health services to get upstream. You'll know the pressures on acute services, where it seems to be a lot. There's a lot of power within acute services. There's some unhelpful issues around the focus on waiting time. Sometimes that draws people back to a more individualised support clinic-based approach, which I think is unhelpful. So that drives some of that. And that's why we're asking for different types of measures that can be helpful and can drive the system. But in the whole system approach, we need to value early intervention prevention and see how important that is. We need to value the whole system approach, where you could have a speech and language therapist, and this is what we're advocating, working in every school and every education placement. And they're not necessarily there to do what people think speech and language therapists do around individualized support, although that is part of it, but they can do stuff around embedding and supporting teachers and practitioners and modeling and coaching context. Formal training is great, but without coaching and modelling context, it doesn't work. We know that from research. So we know this works. I've been working on this for a long time as a speech and language therapist as well. You need a whole system approach. You need people to value that. You need local authorities to value that as well. But in addition to that, you need a threshold resource to deliver it. And I've been saying, yes, we need transformation, but you need adequate resource to deliver it as well.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Clancy, you have some SUPs on this theme.
Thank you. I do, and it relates specifically to the point about behaviour and behaviour as a communication. So I just wanted to ask Glenn, could you tell me how involved has the Royal College been with the summits that the Cabinet Secretary's got on behaviour in schools? Have you been engaged by the government on that?
Honestly, we haven't been as engaged, Pam. Well, clearly, we're making the case around the link between behaviour and communication, but in that specific bit of work, we haven't been involved.
Okay, thank you.
And Liam Kerr?
Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly to pick up this exact theme, Glenn, and specifically on COVID and its impacts. Now, your organisation has made very clear that the interventions you might make need to not just be a one-off, perhaps in the early years, but actually need to cycle right the way through, or ideally cycle right the way through. Did COVID break that kind of contact for a lot of young people? And if so, post-COVID, has that been easy to pick up again? Or have you gone back into the challenges that Ruth Maguire picked up about waiting times, for example? Or even have some people been lost to your interventions?
You're right to say, in terms of, we're seeing a very significant number of kids in early years placements and schools with inadequate spoken language skills. We're hearing from early years practitioners saying pre-COVID they had a small group of non-talkers and a group of talkers, as they define it. But post-COVID, that's been flipped. So that is a worrying trend to hear about. And we know the interventions and the supports that can close the gap for those kids and provide them with the spoken language skills they need and communication they need in order to access their environments. But as you pointed out, that needs to be maintained throughout their school career. As soon as you stop working on communication and spoken language, then that gap can widen. We're seeing a variability across Scotland for quite a lot of services where the pressure is on waiting times, and because the demand has shot up, there's a risk they're being pulled back to old traditional models where they get through the waiting times and that's where they sit, around individualised support rather than the whole system support. So I think absolutely that the pandemic has put extra pressure on that. You add that to the anxiety and the stress staff have been through the pandemic, it's a very difficult place to be. If waiting times are a blunt instrument, actually all they measure is the people in the queue. What they don't measure is the people who can't access that queue. So they're the ones, the most vulnerable people who are struggling, living in poverty, don't necessarily access that type of model as effectively. So they're the ones I'm particularly concerned about.
Waiting. Here we go. Thank you very much. I want to ask something a bit more generic, and we have heard in terms of during COVID, and I think it was yourself, Susie, that spoke about how some of the online learning opportunities were far suited for some of the young people with additional support needs. So I'm wanting to understand a bit more of the challenges that were involved in developing some of the more flexible school education services, either during COVID or keeping them going perhaps now. So if I can start with Susie and then we can move around the rest of the panel. Thank you.
Sure. I think I'd just like to clarify that yes, for some autistic children, young people, they felt that online learning was a more positive experience for them. And a lot of that positive experience will have been because the stress and anxiety of the school environment was removed. So it's about making the school environment inclusive as opposed to necessarily assuming that online learning is the answer. I think online learning definitely has a role to play. And I would say that we don't necessarily feel that there has been sufficient learning around online learning since the pandemic, that where there were maybe autistic children, young people who couldn't go into school and weren't getting an education pre-COVID, and suddenly online learning was available and they could engage in education, and then having gone back to in-school learning, that online option has been removed, and again, they're now not engaging in education. So we haven't, you know, necessarily seen that learning continue into the post-pandemic environment, which has been very disappointing for many families who did benefit in some way. But I don't want to understate the importance of making the school environment inclusive, and I don't want us to all around the table assume that online learning is the answer for all autistic children and young people, because it's not a case of one size fits all. I can't speak specifically to the challenges that schools experienced with putting that online learning in place, but we do know that online learning and not being in this class environment did increase some staff capacity, and that allowed, for example, for more maybe one-to-one with staff and learners that they wouldn't have received necessarily in a class environment. So there was maybe some capacity freed up in some situations as well that learners benefited from.
Online one-to-one?
Yeah, it would have been online one-to-one, and they wouldn't have necessarily received that in school. So that happened in some cases where autistic learners were maybe receiving a little bit more support than they had been pre-pandemic. Mm-hmm. But our survey that we put out specifically for this inquiry did show that of the respondents, over half felt that their support got worse during the pandemic. Yeah. So it's a mixed bag.
Yeah. Okay. Deborah, can I bring you in on that and question two things?
Yeah. We've experienced something very, very similar, and what parents are reporting back to us at the moment, the number of children non-attending school has come off the back of COVID, because for so many of them, the learning environment from the safety of their home was much more suitable to their style of learning. We are aware that there's some children that really wasn't productive for, but overall we find that it's been reported back that so many children preferred learning in that remote way. And, you know, and our thought is, could there be a hybrid model of learning, you know, where young people could attend school, children and young people, when they are able to, but when, you know, they are maybe struggling, that there is still access to that online learning and still access to curriculum from home and attain.
Dina and Irene, you want Dina first, perhaps?
Yes, thanks. I think one of the things that happened for the families who were learning at home during COVID was, for the parents that were able to take up that mantle of doing the home learning with their children, they were sitting alongside their children. They were understanding more about what the children were being required to learn, and they were seeing more closely what it was that their child was struggling with, and they were understanding their child's learning style and learning needs much more than perhaps they had before sending their child to school and just asking them when they got home, how did you get on today? Exactly. And so I think when the schools went back, the parents were much more informed about what their children's needs were and were asking the school for more support that would benefit their child better. And I think that has possibly added to the sort of increase in awareness of additional support needs within the schools and the demands on the schools for suitable supports for the children. But the families we support, who range across all types of neurodiversity, also had similar mixed feelings about the online learning. For some children that was great and they really took to it and would like to continue with it, but for others it doesn't work. So is that, you know, a hybrid model perhaps is giving people choice would be potentially the way forward, because there isn't a one-size-fits-all, unfortunately, for these families.
Before I bring in Irene out, Dina, you know, you spoke about parental involvement with that young person learning.
Yeah.
But obviously in some families, the parental engagement wasn't as positive, shall we say, and that would have a detrimental effect on that young person even more, perhaps?
I think particularly during the first lockdown, when parents were just thought they had to replicate the school day at home. I mean, people just did not know what to do, and it was overwhelming. And even with the online stuff, there was, for some families, there was so much online. It became a full-time job for some of the parents who were able to do it, to administer all the lessons and the different documents and different platforms that were being used. So it was very, very difficult. And some families just simply couldn't deal with that at all. I think maybe by the time of the second lockdown, people were a bit more relaxed and realised that they couldn't replicate the school day, and just to keep their children calm and happy was perhaps going to be as beneficial as actually trying to replicate full-on teaching.
Thank you. Irene, your comments on that? Thanks.
I think the online offer across Scotland was very varied, dependent on where people were within where teachers were within their learning of using these sort of resources. We saw a lot of pupils who didn't engage with learning, didn't engage at all with the online offer. Staff were trying different things. They were phoning, checking in with children in different ways. I know guidance teachers were posing silly questions at times, like what's your favourite flavour of crisps, just to try and get a response. There was a lot of young people who were, for them, online learning just wasn't an option. Children with complex needs, children who don't make eye contact, who don't respond to the questions that are being posed. So we saw staff, trying to send resources home, paper resources. We had, as things progressed, we were able to have some walk and talk sessions as well when it was allowed. There was lots of different ways to try and engage young people, but for some, as Susie said, they loved it. For some children with autism, it was great, and it was the most response we'd had for some people. But the hybrid model for schools would need to come with additional resources. We're already struggling in schools to cover classes. A lot of my colleagues are principal teachers and are covering classes. I know that I myself, as a deputy, spend a lot of time covering classes because absence of staff has increased as well during post-pandemic. Their mental health has suffered too. So while I would really love to be able to welcome a hybrid model, I'm not really sure how, without additional resources, we'd be able to source that in schools.
Thank you very much. Can I come back now to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please? Thanks.
Thank you, convener. And I should have said earlier before I asked my question, Glenn, just to say welcome to all of you. Thank you for all the information you've given us in advance, and also for the information you've shared with us this morning. It's really crucial. I wanted to take a sort of more general question to start with, if that's all right, and possibly for Susie and Deborah, if that's okay. The first action, rather, in the Scottish Government's action plan on pupils with additional support needs is a vision for pupils, and it is that schools should help me be the best I can be, and school is a place where children and young people learn, socialise and become prepared for life beyond school. So could I ask both of you whether you think this is happening, and if not, why not? And then I might have another supplementary, but I'll wait and see how we get on from there.
First of all, I'd just like to say that we do welcome the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan. However, progress has been slow, and it's currently not created the change that we needed to see. And that is very obvious still to this day, because we hear from families every day that do not feel like their autistic child or young person is supported or included in the mainstream school environments. And we see continually that autistic children, young people are forced to, in inverted commas, fail at mainstream before any other option or support is offered. And even still then, families are forced to fight the system to get that support, and many are forced into legal action and engaging a solicitor before a solution is found. So clearly something is not working, and the system is not working for autistic children and young people when it comes to receiving their rights to an education. We don't actually necessarily know the scale of this problem because, for example, recording around part-time timetables is not consistent. and not accurate. So I think this is something that we don't currently understand the scale of, but we know from the families we hear from every day that it is a huge problem for autistic children and young people in terms of engaging in education and not feeling included in school. There are three fundamental things I just want to very quickly mention that are part of the solution to this, and it's environment first, ensuring the school environment is inclusive, and there's lots of things that schools can do, some do very well. The trend towards super schools is potentially unhelpful and quite harmful, depending on what those super schools look like. Training, ensuring that staff have the appropriate level of autism understanding, and that touches on Ruth's earlier point about positive relationships. How can you have a positive relationship with an autistic child or young person if you don't understand what autism is? And the final thing is there will always be a need for specialism within mainstream, and Glenn has touched on that, as have others. We need to ensure that that specialist provision within mainstream is adequately resourced to ensure that schools and education are inclusive of all, and that all young people and children can access their right to an education.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. Can I just ask, if, before I bring in Deborah, the point about the recording of timetabling data that is not what it should be. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us a bit more about that and what you think we need to change to make it more fit for purpose?
Yeah, of course. So a code for recording part-time timetabling was actually only introduced in 2018-19 off the back of the included, engaged and involved guidance. So it's only been recently that schools have started to specifically be able to record part-time timetables. Previously, it would have been recorded as either as some kind of authorised absence under a different code. And obviously we expected, therefore, the recording not necessarily to be great for the first few years because it's a new code. Schools are getting used to how to record it. But the last data set that we had, it was still the case that there's a note against the data saying that this is still inconsistent. There's still significant variation. So it's about ensuring that schools, you know, are following the guidance about recording absences and awareness of what that guidance is, and ensuring that they're specifically recording part-time timetables. I think there is an issue also in schools where schools undoubtedly and teachers are really struggling with resource, and part-time timetables can be a supportive measure and are often used with the intention potentially of being supportive, but actually in a lot of cases, they're a sticking plaster as opposed to being supportive. They're a sticking plaster for a lack of support, and they can actually be quite harmful in that it can be very difficult for young people to get back to full-time education once they're on a part-time timetable. And some part-time timetables, we're talking, you know, it could be 3 hours a week. I've heard of autistic children, young people only receiving 3 hours education a week. So I think there's also an issue in schools with how part-time timetables are being used, and potentially that feeds into them not being recorded accurately because they're seen as a supportive measure, but actually the way in which they're being used is not necessarily always supportive, even if there are the best intentions behind that. I hope that makes sense.
It does. Thank you.
Yeah, just to follow on from Susie there, part-time timetables, you know, something we get lots of negative comments about, and also the informal exclusions. Yep. And parents are coming regularly to take their children out of school for the safety and wellbeing of their child. However, that means that parent has to come out of work, that child's not accessing education. And when I kind of last several years ago challenged that from a parental perspective, I asked to see how that was being recorded on the school register, and it was sent home, you know, sick with permission. It's not there, as in the parent does not want to remove the child from school. It's the school are refusing to keep the child within the school environment. So that has a huge impact in relation to poverty, because parents lose their job. You know, it's really difficult to sustain work. It's really difficult to maintain good physical and mental health, because if you can't go to work and access some respite because your child is either on a part-time timetable or being sent home, you know, most days of the week, you know, you just feel that fundamental right to education has been taken from you. So that is a huge issue. And I think if it's all right, one of our parents gave a wee bit of input. She engages with a lot of other parents through her child's primary school. And I think it kind of covers, you know, a lot of it. So if it's okay, I'll read this out. So she said, from her point of view and experience, many families she speaks to continue to fall between the presumption of mainstream and special needs education. The first of those young people thrust into mainstream who are essentially allowed to fail due to inconsistent or no support, especially in the early years, despite strong evidence of need and promises of support. It would seem now that it is almost a requirement to first fail very badly to then get seriously considered for a specialist placement. She's saying she has even heard this said to families from within education. Meantime, the child and the family endure so much trauma, and trauma is a huge issue, that takes years, if ever, to recover from. Evidence tells us this. The school staff are too traumatised, and we see this with staff absence, unsustainable stress, and even some leaving the teaching profession altogether. The other extreme she sees with her youngest child, she has three autistic children, is when they do get a specialist placement, but the bar of expectation is set so low, and assumptions are made about abilities or lack of, and yet undiscovered potential, so much that life chances and outcomes shrink and become limited. And this is impacting on emotional and mental health and well-being of both the young person and the family. They don't even get a chance as subjects, a chance, I think, to choose subjects. Many can't be offered within that special needs placement. And due to cuts, the model of going to other schools is becoming less and less of an option. So I think traditionally children from the special needs school system would go to other schools to sit higher because they wouldn't be available potentially in their school. However, we also know mainstream education, especially in secondary, would and does not suit many of our highly anxious yet highly able young people. We therefore need a model of education that can better differentiate and celebrate the strengths of all of our young people and offer support that is consistent and not removed when they begin to succeed. They succeed because of good support, not because they suddenly don't need supported anymore, yet often we see it removed just as it's beginning to work. And we say, would we take a ramp away from someone requiring to use a wheelchair because they can then access that room? So it's really looking at these supports are regularly removed once the person starts to make some progress. So instead of presuming mainstream for all, we need to presume a young person's potential and as a collective of families and services find creative ways to unlock and celebrate this potential, however it looks. For this, we need trained staff that not only understand many diverse presentations of neurodivergence, but who can also show genuine compassion and acceptance of our young people and their families, just where they are, even when it isn't easy. We need more peer supports. We also need advocacy so that families can feel empowered and part of the solution, working with services and not always only fighting for them. No one really wins when this level of battle wages on and on. Energies need to be conserved and used widely by working together for the same ends. And that can be summed up as a thriving next generation of young adults who are differently abled and proud to be who they are without apology or limit.
It's Ross Greer, who's got a line of questioning on this thread. Thanks for coming now.
Just to pick up on something there about the SL action plan, welcome the plan, but being frustrated with progress. I just wanted to tease out from that, from your perspective, and if anybody else on the panel has a perspective on this as well, that'd be useful. Is the issue that the plan, it's a good plan, but it's not being implemented quickly enough or well enough? Or is the issue that even if we implemented everything that is currently in that plan, it wouldn't make the kind of progress that you require? The solutions to those are different. If the plan's the problem, we can revise the plan. But if there's a good plan sitting there and it's implementation, then we as a committee will obviously need to understand what the implementation barriers are.
Yeah, thank you for the question. And I do think it's a really important one. I think, so the action plan is a good plan. A lot of the actions within it, however, are quite technical. Some of them are things that probably should have been happening anyway. And we would say that there are some pretty fundamental things missing within the plan. Some of the actions go some way to the solutions that we need, but not necessarily the full way. And so I think there's a mixture of things. Sometimes it is implementation and how the actions are implemented, but also the plan could go further. We do welcome the plan, and we particularly welcome the work that Nate has done, the National Autism Implementation Team, to make sure there are objective measures against the plan, and including measures around exclusion and part-time timetables, which are really important for us to understand the problem. So we really welcome that work, but I think it's a mixture of both. There's a mixture of sometimes the implementation is not happening or not happening the way we would like, but also those kind of fundamental things I spoke about, environment first, training, which we would expect to be mandatory and ongoing, and that ensuring that level of specialism within schools, whether the plan would achieve those things, we would question that.
Thanks very much. I think the plan's due its next revision or update relatively soon. So if you've got any, if you're making a specific submission, a proposal to government on that you were, you'd be able to share with the committee, I think we'd find that very valuable for the purposes of this inquiry.
Thanks, Ross. You finished on that thread, Pam, just double checking.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, yes.
Thank you, convener, for allowing that. Thank you very much for that testimony. The point you made about a ramp being taken away is a really good example of how having support doesn't necessarily mean that's you independent, they will take it away, so it's incredibly important. The point I was going to ask is possibly for Glenn and Irene, and it's around coordinated support plans being in place. And I just wondered if you've got, we know there's a very small number of those in place, and given your role, Glenn, and also potentially Irene, your role or guidance teacher's role, could you maybe talk to us a bit about why you think there are so few in place?
I think that there are so few in place because from a school point of view, you've got your IEP, which gives direct support, and you might be using specialist support within that. You've got your children's plan, which is multi-agency normally, and you've got a lot of support around that. And then when you've got your CSP, it's another plan, because normally your children who are in receipt of a CSP have got these plans already, and the CSP is just coordinating what supports are already in place. It's not adding anything to it. So without, you know, landing people in it, it's a lot more work for very little benefit.
Do you think there should be one specific plan to replace all of those then?
I think you're still always going to need an IEP, different local authorities call them different things, but I think the child's plan does, a good robust child's plan is better than a CSP.
Thank you.
Do you want to come in on that, Dina?
This has been a problem for a long time around the CSPs, and for us as a support service where we are very keen on telling parents and carers and children and young people what their rights are and how to enforce those rights, the CSP is important because it's a legal document and that sets it apart from the child's plan and from the IEP, which are the more practical working documents. And it's a source of frustration that there are so few CSPs. And in fact, there seems to be confusion about, you don't need a CSP because you've got a child's plan. Well, actually, if you meet the threshold for a CSP, you're entitled to a CSP. So when you're advising families about what their rights are, it's also a difficult position to be in, to be saying that actually you're going to struggle to secure those rights. And I think that goes a wee bit to Ross's question about the ASL plan, however good the plan is, if there's no real accountability for delivery of what's in the plan, then, you know, it's not going to take us far enough, fast enough.
Deborah's keen to come in on this as well. Okay. Someone will put your mic on for you, Deborah. Oh, okay.
Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. CSPs, if we go back to just the child plan, majority of parents that we engage with don't even have a plan. There's planning, but there's nothing on paper. Inquiry will say go back to the child's plan, but when you don't have a plan, from the school, it's very difficult to go back to that. The CSP, I know on one council website, the link to apply was there and then it was removed, so it's not even visible to parents anymore. So they don't even know how they would start that process. And again, that process has to be formally requested. We do regularly flag it up to parents, and the difficulty they have quite often in that process being started and being discouraged as to that they don't need the CSP. For my own son, when he was at school, we did have, and I thought it was highly valuable and definitely required over and above his individual plan. But your average parent isn't even aware of the CSP plan, and if they have CAMHS involved or social work, they automatically should be able to apply for that plan, but it isn't highlighted nor suggested.
And Glenn Carter, do you want to come in as well?
Thanks very much. I was speaking about a practitioner having worked in this before. Clearly, the parents' view of this is really important about whether they feel it's beneficial or not. Although I think Irene raises an important point, where services are working well, when we were working and things were well coordinated, we felt in some ways it was a paper exercise because things were going really well locally. But there's no doubt the CSPs add weight. And it does ensure that services focus down on how are we really going to coordinate around the needs of this particular child. But a good child's plan can be very, very effective as well. So clearly we don't want to turn into it being a combative type approach, but it can have its place.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bill Kidd, can we come to yourself now, please?
Thank you very much, convener. Thanks very much for everything, the breadth and depth of your replies. So I'm going to give you something to give you a bit of breadth and depth opportunity, if you will. In 2019, the Scottish Government published guidance on the presumption to provide education in a mainstream setting. Well, given the tight financial situation facing the public sector in Scotland, where might any additional resource have the most impact in supporting outcomes for pupils with additional support needs, please? I don't know who might want...
Dina. That's you on.
Thanks. I do think, to echo one of Susie's themes, training would be very important, and I think initial teacher education could be broadened out to include much better training for teachers coming into the profession, and indeed other additional support staff in the schools around neurodiversity and other disabilities and additional support needs.
Okay, thank you very much. Anyone else? Irene, and then I think Susie and Deborah and everybody just go. Irene, please.
I would echo training as well. We have a finite time in schools to be able to train because of our in service days, to be able to make it compulsory training. And that impacts on the training that we can provide for pupil support assistants as well, who are really, really valuable to support learning and to support our young people in schools. And they're the ones, most pupil support assistants in Scotland work a 27.5-hour week. So there is no extra time at the end of the day to offer training. It's all done through goodwill, or released. If we release pupil support assistants from school to engage in training, then there's no supply list there to be able to replace. And if you are fortunate enough to be able to get a supply person in to replace the person that's away on the training, they don't know the needs of the children, and they're not able to support effectively. One of the things that I can't remember who it was on the panel that spoke about earlier was about super schools. We're building schools that are really big. We need to be, in my opinion, looking at the environment that we're expecting children to learn in. We're seeing a lot of sort of open schools with large, airy buildings that are quite similar maybe to hospitals or to shopping malls. So you have a child who's dysregulated on the ground floor, and it can impact on the learning across the whole school, and there's very little you can do about it. So looking at our school buildings, I think if we were able to look at the possibility of some junior highs, so you've got schools where there's better transition arrangements just built into the actual fabric of the building, better opportunities for staff to get to know young people, better opportunities for our allied health professionals to work and do through work with the young people. That would be, I think, helpful. I'm a teacher, so I'm going to say reduction in class size would also be really beneficial, and an increase in support staff.
Good.
Who's next? Everyone wants to come in. Susie, then Glenn, I think we'll go for.
Thank you. Yeah, I just want to flag, first of all, pleased to hear such support for the idea of training. I'd just like to flag that some of this work has already been done. So Strathclyde University carried out pilots on introducing a training module on autism into ITE, initial teacher education. So that has been developed by Strathclyde University. It's been piloted. The evaluation was very positive. Strathclyde University now deliver that training as part of their ITE course, and I believe as part of their PGDE, but don't quote me on that one. Probably want to check with Strathclyde University. And they've made that module available to all providers of initial teacher education throughout Scotland. So that module is there to be used. We don't know how many providers are using it. So some of this work has already been done, and it wouldn't necessarily cost any money to put it in place. It's just a case of providers putting that training in place. Obviously, that only accounts for new teachers, not existing, so there is still an issue around existing teachers, and I think certainly that would be a good place to put resource. There are the issues around protected time and capacity of teachers, which would need to be addressed, but certainly that would be a very good place to put resource. I'm not going to say one thing is more important than the other, because that's not the case. They're all very important. But I would say if we're building schools, let's be cognizant of the environment. If you're spending that money anyway, let's spend it well and spend it correctly. The specialist provision within mainstream is going to be the most expensive thing. So there's an argument there potentially that that is where some of that resource needs to go. But I'm not going to say one thing's any more important than the other.
Before we bring Glenn in, from the evidence last week, we had some questioning around that initial teacher training mm-hmm. element, and it's interesting to hear your comments around Strathclyde mm-hmm. University. We have written off to get some clarification to the Scottish Council of Deans of Education
sure.
to get some information as to what is provided, so yeah. that's helpful to join that in.
I can also provide a contact at Strathclyde University
helpful.
Who led on the pilot
Thank
to
you.
The committee, if that's helpful.
And so, sorry about that, Glenn, over to yourself now.
Thanks, Bill. It's a great question, and I think we need to be brave to stop doing what doesn't work. And, you know, my view, and I've talked about the whole system, schools and education, nurseries are complex, dynamic environments. Teachers and nurse workers are so busy, there's lots of things to juggle. And having done this for years and years, the power is in the local relationships. If you have people embedded in the team, I think specialists should be closer to the population. Where are the population? They're in schools, they're in nurseries. That's where we should be located, in my view. So continuing on with medical type approaches in an education setting, I don't think is working. Extracting a child, doing a bit of work and expecting them to be fixed and putting them back into an environment which hasn't been adapted isn't the right way forward. Now, we've done loads of work on this. The balance system is a great example of it, where you take a whole system approach to it. You adapt the environment with the school. It's not the expert coming in. It's the working as a team to improve the environment, to improve how we interact with kids. And so training, of course, is important. You need quality training. But the thing that facilitates behaviour change and a shift in how we facilitate kids' communication is being in there and coaching and modelling with other people, and not just throwing training at them and then walking away. Because we know that throwing training at people rarely works without follow-up and without coaching and modelling. So we need to be brave. We need to stop doing what doesn't work, and making sure that we improve the outcomes of the kids, because we can't wait any longer for us to continue with the models that aren't working.
Thank you.
Thank you on that, Bill.
Deborah. Hand up, actually.
Someone will put your button on for you on this one.
Thank you. So following on the design of the schools, we are getting, you know, more people struggling with this open plan format and when children run, you know, fight or flight response to regulate, you know, they are running through the whole school. Also thinking of the sensory aspect of, you know, the noise coming from other rooms, you know. So they all seem to be, you know, in this kind of new open plan design. So question is, who is the architect? Could that be changed going forward? But yeah, when you have lots of children with ESNs, no doors on classrooms aren't ideal. An area that comes up for us a lot is the de-escalation of children within the school environment, where they're removed from the classroom too. So many schools have nurture rooms, nurture teachers, you know, quiet rooms. There's all different names for these breakaway spaces. Again, what's happening in these spaces, quite often children are removed from the learning and put into this room with a support teacher for sometimes the full day. They are not accessing the curriculum. So what is the purpose of going to this room? The training that our trainer delivers at Deaf and Abled Scotland, she has a background in sensory integration. So it's really looking, should every school, every nursery have a proper sensory environment where children and young people can go to de-escalate? And there's still too much focus on, I kind of struggle with the lights in here, but the lights, the sounds. It's really, I've got friends, you know, that are in education, and again, it's kind of trying to unpick that. What does the sensory environment mean? There really has to be that strong focus on vestibular and proprioception, maybe some movement activities, not so much nice lights and fancy textures and low sounds, but for those young people and children to actually be able to burn off some energy. And for those that require movement, it means that they can quite potentially easily go back into the classroom environment and be in a much calmer place to learn and attain. So the training, Deaf-Abled, we did pilot training with some Glasgow schools, and we delivered that in service days. We also delivered it in the staff development time. I've got a friend that's a head teacher, you know, and again, we know time and provision, and for teachers to get cover to be trained, it is really difficult. When training has sometimes been booked in service days, then the local authority at short notice then changes the plan, and it has to be cancelled because there's something more mandatory has to come in. But again, staff development time, you know, I think there's the hour and a half sometimes after, you know, the school day. Is that a slot where potentially some training could potentially be happening? The other thing within the school environment, and this comes from a lot of the young people, I don't know if you heard it during the consultation with them, my son always reported back that he couldn't learn. They are not attaining in maths and English currently. Lots of our neurodivergent children, because more often than not, they are removed from the main set and taken down to the subset within the school, which is the smaller group environment with more support, slower speeds for learning. But for many of them, it's a disruptive learning environment. There'll be a lot of movement in the class, a lot more noise, a lot more chatting. And, you know, there really has to be somewhere else in a small group format that these children can be taken to in small group format in school, because the number of them that are not attaining NAT 5 English and maths, and that is going on to really have a huge impact and their progression throughout life. With school league tables as well, in my own personal opinion, they should be abolished, because so many of the young people are refused to be presented for NAT 5s for fear of the grades, and they are being kept at NAT 4. So again, that really, you know, impacts on their progression post-school. So that's an area that's flagged up for us very regularly.
Thank you very much.
And I know we've had a little bit of commentary there about the physical estate and things, and I've got Liam Kerr is going to be asking some questions around that later on. But can I come to subs from Willie Rennie and then Ben McPherson, please? Thanks.
So Glenn, your point, I think, comes to the heart of what was discussed last week, because there was a discussion about compulsory training, and it was felt that that would be inappropriate because there isn't one type of additional need. There's a huge range, and it's constantly moving. And I presume the training is constantly moving as well. So your point is, rather than expecting teachers to be an expert on everything all the time, we should actually reflect on that model and go back and say we need specialists to assist directly, rather than putting that extraordinary pressure on teachers to be up to date on everything all the time. Is that your summary of...
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that because, and we say experts, sometimes, as I'm going back to my original point, we think they should come into the placement and do individual therapy with kids. Now, some kids do need that, but there's so much going on for teachers and each class is different and the needs of that class is different. So you've got to be able to adapt to the needs of that class and that child. And the way it works, there's no doubt in my mind, is having relationship and trust in the setting. And if you don't have it, you can have an expert come in, give advice and then go back out again. But unless there's trust and you have you allow a bit of safety there to change practice, then rarely works in my view. So you've got to have people close to be able to do that work. So I agree with that point.
So I want to be a wee bit provocative because I think you disagree with the other members of the panel. I think the other members of the panel are saying, some have even mentioned compulsory training. Can I just flush this out? What actually do you think the consensus is on this? Are we for compulsory? Do we want every teacher to be an expert? Or are we relying on more pulling in experts when it's required? Susie, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I do. I could tell you're being provocative, and I'm going to come back and say that I don't doubt that there is a need for specialism within the mainstream setting, but we have to acknowledge that there is a large range of additional support for learning needs. Looking specifically at autism is a spectrum. So I think I want to just flag that there is potentially quieter majority here of autistic children and young people who are in school, are engaging to some extent in education, are not necessarily disruptive in the classroom or perceived as challenging, don't necessarily need the input of speech and language therapy or additional support for learning teachers, don't need to use a BASE. Maybe their difficulties are more with their peers, maybe they're very socially isolated, maybe there are particular classes that they're not doing well in, but because they're not disruptive, because they're not causing problems, in inverted commas, for the school, then there's very little necessarily resource put into ensuring that they have a good school experience. I would say for those children and young people, actually, that's where the training comes in. So it's really important that school staff understand the autistic experience, understand what it means to be autistic, understand how children and young people might present if they are autistic and what they might do, so that they can identify maybe where someone is isolated, where someone is being bullied, where someone is struggling to focus in class, and support that child or young person. So I don't think it's necessarily an either-or situation, I would say.
You could be a good liberal. So actually... we need to be clear from this.
Yeah.
What we're saying is that the type of training for teachers needs to be much more clearly defined. Rather than expecting the full spectrum of stuff to be taught, we need to understand which groups require an expert brought in and which group requires the teacher to play the central role. Now, there might be a bit of both on that again, mm-hmm. but... is that what you're saying? We need to be much better at defining what we're actually asking teachers to do.
I think we need to certainly have realistic expectations of what teachers can do. And I think the training needs to match what we can expect teachers to do within their role. I don't think we can expect teachers to have, you know, a specialist understanding in speech and language therapy or even in, you know, additional support for learning and being an additional support for learning teacher, which, you know, you can specialise in being an additional support for learning teacher. Don't expect them necessarily to be experts in behaviour either. So I think the training needs to match what we're expecting teachers to do, and where additional resource is needed, that specialist resource needs to be embedded within the mainstream setting.
And do you think education leaders understand what you've just said?
I think education leaders do understand that, and I think that teachers most teachers want to go out and get the training, and actually we see teachers and schools coming to us asking for the training, but it's getting the time to do that and ensuring that it is, you know, ongoing in some way, that there's opportunities to refresh and that learning is put into practice as opposed to necessarily one off and that's it, done and dusted. So, but I do think there is an understanding of that.
And I suppose that embedded and ongoing leads into the coaching that Glenn's been telling us on several times this morning. Do you want to come in on Willie Rennie's comments, Glenn Carter?
Well, just to clarify, I think quality training is absolutely required. That is a core facet of this work. Now, teachers play a central role in all the kids. They're the ones who are with these kids every day, which is why we do need to empower them. They don't necessarily have to be the expert in everything, but they need to know who to go to, and that support needs to be available when is required. So hopefully that clears.
Well, let me just clear then. What are you saying when you said earlier on the system isn't working? We need to stop doing the same over. What precisely did you mean with that then?
So let me paint a picture. In my view, what works is we take a whole system approach to this. So you embed people like speech and language therapists in an education setting. They're not necessarily doing all the individual work or all the work, right? But they're working with teachers to empower them to do some of this. Because communication is so prevalent, for instance, they need some level of a base level of knowledge and skills. Those therapists develop relationships with the teachers. Yes, they provide formal training, but they also are available to do stuff in a whole class, in a group, or an individual setting. And they help facilitate the environmental change, they help identification, and provide support around effective interventions in context. Because this is about, you know, kids are asking for the needs, their needs to be adapted to and differentiated. And so teachers need support with that.
So you've not actually answered my question. So what's not working?
What's not working is the general model, because we don't have enough resource, is that some of these kids are having to be extracted from educational placements, have a bit of something, and then are put back in, and the environment has not been adapted.
Okay. Thank you.
That was very provocative of you, Willie Rennie. And still on this theme of training, we've got Ruth McGuire wanting to come in before I come to Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just briefly, and I think it's been a very interesting interaction and a helpful one. I think quite often that a lot of us can think that the answer is to cram everything into initial teacher training, which it clearly isn't. I just wondered if panel members had any examples, and I would recognise the model that Glenn Carter's talking about in terms of allied professionals being kind of embedded and children's teams being embedded, but it often, in my experience, it's a specific school. It's not across the board, even within a local authority area. I don't know if this is maybe a question for Irene, if there are any examples, given the challenges of getting cover for training and coaching and these things for teachers, where work is done within the classroom and perhaps even with the children and the teacher, so that it's beneficial to everyone, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and I don't want to always come back to speech and language therapy, but they are a really good example because communication is key. So my experiences have been when I've worked alongside a speech and language therapist, not in my current role, but as a teacher, and I have had them be part of my class, part of the young people that I'm working with. So they're maybe there for a specific young person, but the whole class can benefit from it because you're learning about a programme. You're learning about a specific piece of work which you will meet with a speech and language therapist, discuss what needs to be done, how different approaches for it, and then you as the class teacher will then go on and deliver that piece of work, but keep the contact with the speech and language therapist to be able to get feedback, adapt things and assess where the young person is. So that's one way that I found really helpful, and it's an easy way to work as a teacher because you're not being taken away, you know, from your class. It's something that's manageable within your class time. Because when we're looking at offering training for staff, we're kind of starting through our improvement planning process, and we're making decisions, you know, a year in advance about what training's going to need to be covered, and that then you have something different appear and that becomes a priority, but you're not able to always address it the best way. I know local authorities are engaging in things like circle training where there's a local authority lead and they're given over time to meet with members of each school, and the member of the school will take on board the circle training. And so that's something that's happening across
the
areas.
Can I just briefly come back? When you said the improvement plans are done a year in advance, obviously they're prepared without knowing what children are in the classroom and what their needs are.
You won't necessarily know your new intake. You'll know quite a lot about them because of the transition work you're doing.
Okay.
But it might not always catch the ones that appear later on.
Sure. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for your patience, Liam Kerr.
Yeah, very grateful. Just to go back to something that was said earlier, I'll start with Deborah Bess and I'll go to Irene Stove, but I appreciate other members may wish to come in. Deborah, you were talking about the physical environment and you made some suggestions. I'd just like to give you the chance to elaborate on that. How do you suggest that the school estate's physical spaces could be adapted to support pupils, particularly given the resource constraints? And who should be leading on collating and driving forward those solutions?
Big question. So again, back to sensory integration and probably what's needed within these spaces. As far as I'm aware, there's only 5 trained sensory integration OTs in Scotland that have this background of understanding the sensory system and how to regulate, you know, to that therapeutic level. Could there be OTs within schools? Could there be specialist OTs that maybe, you know, are kind of pulled again, you know, amongst various other schools? There's just this lack of, apparently in the UK we're quite behind in relation to sensory integration and that understanding of the sensory needs of many of our neurodivergents. And I think even the dyspraxics, the DCDs, haven't been spoken about today, you know, even just we say we're dyslexics. But there's this tradition that people are kind of removed to a shared space where so many of these children need a personal space to move into, to de-escalate. For example, my own son in the secondary school environment, he had access to a small room and access to Classic FM and some headphones, and that was all that he needed, was to kind of go to this space and de-escalate. Then he could re-engage into education. I think I've wandered off from what you initially asked me.
No, that's hugely useful. I'll put the question to Irene Stove, but if you think of something, that just catch my eye and we'll come back. So, Irene Stove, do you have any thoughts, given your experience, on what needs to happen to adapt the physical school estate for all pupils, and particularly counter, you raised an example earlier about the dysregulated child on the ground floor of the super schools, I think you called it. Any particular points on that?
I think when we're building new schools, we need to really think about the environment and speak to the teachers, to our partners who work with the young people, so that we can make sure that the space that we're providing is going to be fit for purpose. We need to look at our outdoor spaces as well. A lot of children, a way for them to be co-regulated and be able to, you know, regulate themselves is to get outdoors. But that needs to be done in a safe outdoor space. So we need to know that if we've got someone who's someone used the term runner earlier, and that's how I would describe some young people as well. If they're a runner, we've got to be able to keep them safe. A lot of schools are community areas, so that the gates aren't locked and the children can run out into busy roads. So we need to think about how we keep everyone safe in our schools. We need in our buildings, we need to have some adaptable spaces. So you might be looking at a sensory room in a school, but you might actually want it to be also a low arousal room. So you might want to think about how schools are resourcing that and how they're making, because if you have a sensory room, you generally can't, there's a lot of stimulation and some children can't cope with that. So if you're able to have a room that has sensory equipment that can come into it and be taken out, so that it can be adaptable for the use of young people. What Deborah said about having areas in the school where you can just, de-stress That's really important, having little breakout rooms, whether those are outdoors or indoors, depending on the age group as well, I think is something that you need to think about. The noise is in some schools, it's so echoey, it can be really difficult if you've got a hearing impairment to be able to focus. Our buildings, quite a lot of them, they might have big glass panels on the sides of the doors, which is great as a member of the SLT, so you can just walk past and you can see how things are going in that classroom. However, if you're a young person with ADHD and you've got someone running or, you know, in the corridors, your ability to focus is really, really, really difficult, really challenged by that. So I think more consultation with staff who know young people and know the needs of the young people in the community that are really listened to, because over the years I've been involved in consultations for new builds and it's not always been listened to, and I know that's the same for my colleagues in the committee.
Susie Martin.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to come in and say that, you know, we acknowledge that it's extremely challenging potentially to retrospectively adapt existing school buildings, some of which are potentially going to be quite old at this point. And that's not necessarily a cheap thing to do either. New schools is another matter. It's about spending the money well. But when it comes to the existing school estate, I think there's things that can be done. And I think there are things that can be done that don't necessarily require lots and lots of resource. However, caveat that with that shouldn't be a reason not to fund appropriate and you know, adaptations to school. But we recognise that, you know, resources are not necessarily readily available for the kind of adaptations that would be, you know, the ideal situation. The National Autism Implementation Team has some great guidance on, for example, safe spaces for children and young people. And I think there's been a lot of talk around sensory rooms and things like that, which can have value, but we need to understand that a safe space for an autistic child or young person should be individual to that autistic child or young person. Otherwise, you're going to potentially end up with 10 children and young people in a sensory room at a given time who are all wanting to use it at the same time, and at that point it doesn't particularly become necessarily useful for anyone. So, you know, these rooms potentially do have value, but actually it's about the individual child, and the National Autism Implementation Team does have great guidance, and it can be really simple things. For example, there's a high backed chair in this particular area of the school that autistic young person can go to, and it feels enclosed, it's private, and it allows them to regulate. Something as simple as a high backed, you know, soft chair, I think you've got some of them in the Parliament probably, can be a really helpful tool. Something as simple as there is a desk at the back of this class with some maybe sensory toys at it, that if a particular young person needs to, they can remove themselves to that desk at the back of the class where they can't be kind of like looked at by other pupils. The example of having glass panes in doors, you know, potentially it's as simple as putting a bit of paper over those glass panes if you know that there's a child with ADHD who does struggle to focus if it's kicking off in the corridor. If there's, you know, other people kicking off in the corridor, there's people walking past. So there are things you can do, I think, within the existing school estate that will help, that don't necessarily need to come at huge cost, but I don't think that should be a reason not to spend the money if the money is there to spend to make proper adaptations to schools. So yeah, I just wanted to...
Dina's keen to come in on this as well, and apologies if you wanted to speak in the last questions.
Let me pose the question, if you could, convener, because yes, I'm keen to hear your thoughts, Dina, but also if you can also deal with how Susie's point about individualising the need relates to your proposals and your submission. You mentioned a universal design for learning. And I wonder, because I couldn't quite find what you meant by that, and I wonder if you might elaborate on that. And if there's a universal design, how does it relate to the individualisation that we've just heard about?
I think the principle of universal design is that you build a more flexible, more adaptable environment from the ground up, so that when you have somebody who needs individual specialisation, you're making more minimal adjustments. You're not having to go in and start from scratch to make the adjustments for that person, because the environment itself is more flexible. and the way that pupils are taught is more flexible. The curriculum is designed in a more flexible way so that it accommodates different styles of learners much more easily as it's being delivered in the classroom. And that links to what I was wanting to just mention, is that we do already have legislation in place. It's quite old. I think local authorities have forgotten that they have the requirement, but they should all have an accessibility strategy. So, and that should deal with the estate, it should deal with communication, and it should deal with curriculum as well. And so for us, if we're trying to support parents to access their rights and entitlements, we might say to them, well, check out your local authority accessibility strategy. And that's meant to be proactive as well. It's, you know, a lot of what we're discussing is reactive. We're presented with a child who's not managing. How do we adapt to cope for that child? But actually, we should be planning ahead. And these types of adaptations that we've heard would be wonderful in the schools, and they would make a huge difference, and they'd make a difference for all the children, not just some of the children that we're particularly focusing on this morning.
Thank you. I've got supplementaries on this from Willie Rennie, and then Ben McPherson first, sorry, and then Willie Rennie. Sorry, Ben, I was looking.
Thanks, convener. I just have a few questions, so bear with me. First of all, thanks for all that you do and for being with us today and for your submissions. With absolute appreciation that, to use the phrase that one of you did, no one size fits all. The individual needs of every student, young person is important. And with an appreciation that you've already covered many different areas, whether it's staff training and specification, continued professional development, the facilities in the estate, and the support that third parties give. With regard to the reconsideration of the action plan and how we go from identifying the problems and the challenges to where can we find solutions and improvement, what, in your view, could be change that is deliverable that would improve things on a consistent basis? Because to me, what's coming through from all of you is that the consistency of support is a real challenge in different parts of Scotland, or depending on how empowered different families feel, what the information is that they have. Now, how do we get to a better position of consistent support with an appreciation of the fact that every individual child's needs are their own? I don't.
Thank you. Yeah. Again, it isn't one size fits all, but those three fundamental things that I mentioned at the start, and I think they are all, you know, equally as important as one another. You know, so there's not necessarily one thing that I would say that we should change that is deliverable. But certainly I think schools require direction and some resource to make environmental changes. And I think the direction on that is quite important, ensuring that they know where to find the guidance on what changes work for children and young people. So it's not just about go and make adaptations. Actually, let's provide direction and guidance to schools about what that should look like and how they can go about putting that in place. That would make a big difference. And I think there are things you can do with the existing estate, you know, even though that does pose challenges.
So we need a specific set of guidance for all 32 local authorities that says, with your buildings, you should seek to do ABCD or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, we said in our written submission that schools need direction and resource when it comes to making environmental changes, and that does need to be, you know, sustained. It can't just be go and do this and then that's it. You know, they need to be encouraged to, you know, make changes over a period of time and improve those adaptations where they can. So, but they do need that guidance and that direction, I think. And I think also the basic understanding from our perspective of autism is fundamental for all staff. You know, that, you know, with the nuances of specialism is always required, staff have to have a fundamental understanding of what autism is. Not all staff do. They might,
and that's training and continuous professional development.
That's what we would want to see. Yeah, training and continuous professional development. The first place to start is ITE. The pilot's been done. The evaluation has been done. The module is there. Let's use it. And then the final thing is ensuring that all mainstream settings have an element of specialism embedded, because that's always going to be required, and you know, not all schools do, and some schools have some but not enough. Some schools have great, you know, specialist resources in place, but maybe they, you know, they have issues around recruitment and the number of staff that they have in place. But that's a trickier thing, and I think, you know, others have talked about that whole system approach, and that is where that whole system approach comes in.
Thanks, Susie Martin. Sorry to cut you off, but
nope,
to kind of feed onto Glenn Carr, yep. I mean, you argued earlier that there's not capacity in the system. We don't have enough trained people to provide that specialism in every required setting.
Yeah.
So is that a priority for you, that we need to increase the capacity?
Well, absolutely. And I think there's the two key things are, of course, the system needs to transform, but we need adequate resource. If you try and do one without the other, it's not going to work, and I keep saying that. And to go back to your point about the consistency, you're absolutely right. Back to Equity for All, there's areas in Scotland with the highest need with the lowest level of speech and language therapy resource, and that is a real concern for me, particularly for families living in poverty. So there's this, you know, you can have brilliant policy, and I think we do have excellent policy in Scotland, but there's a bridge between that and practice. And what is it that allows you to deliver excellent policy into practice? And I keep going back to the power of local relationships. So yes, we need quality training, we need quality guidance, and we need to, but there's also something we can do at a national level about accountability, about measures and outcomes. What are we counting? Is it the right things? And how is that driving the system unhelpfully? But locally, what we can do is try and understand the needs of that local population and then deliver what we need together. So it's about facilitating, and I think government can do that, facilitating some quality guidance, but facilitating some of that integrated practice on the ground. So it is complex. But
and you, absolutely. And you talked about access to queue earlier. Do you want to just elaborate on that slightly?
Access and queue, did you say?
Yeah, that was the phrase you used earlier.
Yeah, so
how do we improve that on a consistent basis?
Well, so waiting times don't measure demand. And when we transformed locally in the previous service I worked in, we got close to the population. We saw the huge amount of demand there. So we unveiled that demand because we're working in a different way. That's not a bad thing, but it's the reality. And in order to serve that population, the most vulnerable people living in poverty, we can't expect them to travel two bus rides to a community clinic to access services. It's got to be delivered closer to home. So that's my view.
I've got more questions. Deborah Best.
Sorry, Ben, I'm looking at the time and I've got other people to come in another section. So if you can make your questions more concise, please.
OK, well, I'm trying to consolidate. Thank you. I will do, convener. Sorry, just Deborah Best, you also talked about the average patient isn't aware of the plan. Is that the a key takeaway that we can take from you?
Yes, so many parents are unaware of their right to have planning and their need to have planning, and without having meaningful planning and, you know, having actions raised and, you know, reviewing plans, it's really difficult to move forward. So, you know, that's a basic fundamental that every SN child, you know, requires a plan, and it gives that and again, working with that parent to create that plan. Sometimes plans come and they've kind of been done from the educational perspective without the parental input.
And do you think that there needs to be greater consistency? And
absolutely, and it's back to, you know, I think nationally with planning and with everything we've spoken about, as a postcode lottery, some areas, you know, there's much better support than others, and again we still have huge issues around the highest performing schools and the reduced supports for a lot of the ASN pupils because of, you know, the league tables and attainment that prioritises. But very quickly, you know, I know there's been the talk of the training. For me, I think it's fundamental, has to be mandatory, because so many of these young neurodivergent, the children and young people, are being missed in the first instance, because when the evidence is requested from the educational environment as to what's, you know, being seen from that perspective, many parents are currently actually being told that their child won't be taken forward for neurodevelopmental assessment because the nursery or the school are not seeing what they are seeing. And if you have a child or young person that is internalising, that's extremely worrying. And again, you know, raising that, under the ASN Act, every one of these children is entitled to supports, but again, all too often that's not happening without diagnosis.
Thank you. I don't know if our other two witnesses want to add on consistency, yeah, but I'm happy to ask my other questions later if there's time, convener.
Thank you, Ben. I'm just conscious that the planning element was coming up from...
Sure.
But that's okay. I didn't... Does anyone else want to comment on the questions from Ben McPherson? Irene, over to you.
I just want to say, you know, like, the consistency, the, you know, the deliverable thing that we could do consistently is making sure there's, like, staff on the ground as a first place. You know, there are areas within Scotland which is really difficult to recruit staff to. So if we could look at how we solve that problem and encourage more teachers into profession and allow them to stay in the profession as well, I think that would help.
And I know, Dina, yourself, and then I know Willie's got a supplementary in this theme as well before we move on to Stephanie Callaghan. Dina.
Yeah, I don't know if it sits under consistency, but I'm really keen to highlight the importance of homeschool partnerships. A lot of the work that we do is around restoring broken relationships between families and schools, because families have just lost faith that the education system is going to be able to provide for their child, or they've withdrawn their child from school, not because they want to homeschool, but because they don't think that the school can provide the right support. And one way to achieve better homeschool relationships is to provide more time for teaching staff and the educational staff in the school to spend time with the families, because very often, what does this child need? You don't need to wait for a diagnosis. You could have a discussion with the family and with the child or young person themselves, and they would be able to indicate what would make a difference and what would work better within the school. But teaching staff just don't have enough time to spend on homeschool communication and building those relationships. It's back to relationships again with the families.
Thank you. Willie Rennie, sorry.
Have we moved on from buildings?
No, you're still in that theme space, if you wish. Yes,
that's fine. So, have you got good examples of where new buildings have been constructed that are sympathetic to this? And your discussions with government and local authorities, what do they say?
Irene, maybe?
No.
Sorry, I don't.
Any examples, good places?
Susie, do you have anything?
I can't give any examples of fantastically adapted mainstream settings off the top of my head.
Okay.
But happy to go away and come back to the committee with some information on that. I would say that, you know, we are approached by a lot of schools who want to either undertake training or potentially do some kind of autism friendly within the school, and we try to facilitate that where possible. But usually our conversations are directly with schools as opposed to the local authority.
So I'm talking about when they're building new buildings.
Yep.
I presume you try and make some kind of input into the design.
We wouldn't necessarily as an organisation,
but you try and make the case for it.
Obviously the local community would be consulted. I think there's probably something about ensuring that specifically families of children and young people with additional support needs are consulted as a group as part of that process.
But in terms of specialist advice on what kind of buildings they should be building, because we are building a lot of schools, and it's alarming that they're not really fitting in with the mainstream policy that the government's got in place.
Yep.
So what are we doing about that?
I mean, when it comes to our organisation, we do have a training consultancy team that can advise, certainly, on this kind of thing in terms of public spaces, including schools and the like. But it's not something that we do regularly with local authorities.
Anybody gone to Jenny Gilruth and said, what on earth are you doing?
Dina.
No?
No, I'm
No.
Okay.
not yet, anyway. Again, I suppose it does come back to training because, I mean, there must be architectural services in each local authority who are advising on the design of these buildings, and perhaps they also need more training in the needs of the particular populations. We've heard about sensory environments and hard, cold surfaces that are, we've all been in noisy restaurants where you can't hear a word, and, you know, also... the toll it takes on teaching staff to project and so on.
I just want to say very quickly that actually ensuring that public spaces are autumn friendly is part of our new three-year strategy as an organisation. So it is something that we are looking at as an organisation and how we achieve that. And obviously part of that has to be working with local authorities across the whole of the UK. So that work will be happening over the course of the next 3 years as an organisation. But obviously... there are different relationships in different places and different people that we will need to speak to. And I don't have specific examples at this point.
Okay, that's me.
Thank you. Now, thank you, Stephanie Callaghan, online, waiting patiently to come in. Over to you, Stephanie. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. And just before we move on from talking about buildings, I'm interested in whether the panel think that safe spaces, be they wellbeing rooms, sensory rooms, small rooms, as a minimum, should every school have one at this point in time? And maybe that's something that we could do more quickly. And also, is there a need for them to be accessible throughout the school day and not close at some points as well? But I saw in the evidence, you know, talk about children wandering around into toilets and things because there wasn't a space for them to go to. Thanks.
Can you direct your question to someone initially, please, Stephanie?
I haven't been able to see Convener, who's been answering questions at all points in time, so I'm not quite sure.
In terms of
Susie.
Thanks for your question, Stephanie. I think wellbeing rooms and sensory rooms certainly have value. As I said before, I think we don't want to fall into the trap of that's the place where everyone goes if they need to regulate, because you could end up with 10 or more children and young people in a given space at a given time. The NAIT guidance does say that safe spaces for children and young people should be available whenever they need them. So it shouldn't be a case of you can't access them. You can't access your safe space during class time. It kind of defeats the purpose. So they should be available whenever a child or young person needs them. They should be accessible, and children and young people should be there, be able to go there safely, independently, not being escorted. So those are the kind of things that NAIT advises. So I'll leave it there.
And I've got Irene wanting to come in as well. Thanks, Irene.
Just to say that, yes, I do think this should be in all schools. I'm in my post for the last 10 months, I think it is, and during that time we have purchased two safe spaces for our school, and we've also adapted another room. However, I would say that they do need to be managed. You do need to be able to keep an eye on the young person when they're in the safe space, so that they're not, they don't find themselves with other children who could actually trigger them as well. So it does need to be carefully managed.
Thank you very much for that. Now, Stephanie, over to you for your next set of questions. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Convener. So I want to ask about formal planning processes there. Do they support better outcomes for pupils, in the panel's opinion, complex needs? And also on the other side of that, I suppose, about getting the balance right, is there also a need to recognise and respect the expertise of parents, carers, autistic children and young people as well, to identify their needs and their challenges and how to overcome those effectively with advocacy support if that's needed there? Thanks.
Who'd like to come in first on the formal planning process? Dina, is that for you? No? You don't need to. You can...
No, I don't mind.
Deborah's votes. And offered. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you.
Yeah, as we've spoke about already, the formal planning, really important, fundamental, and, you know, for the school to have to build and have that working relationship with the parent or the carer, it's really important that planning is happening, and it's happening, you know, jointly. Because we always say, you know, as the parent, you are the expert on your child. And it's key that the parent is able to contribute, you know, aspects of their child or young person's presentation and information as such as included within that plan. Within our training, we work very much with communication passports and personal profiles, sensory diets. Again, you know, a profile for ASN pupils would be extremely useful. And again, various staff members coming into contact with that child or young person then has a brief overview of their presentation, some of the triggers, some de-escalation information, and that could be really beneficial.
Glenn, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah. I think as part of the formal planning process, the voice of the child is so important, and quite often they don't have their voice heard, and particularly difficult for children with communication needs. However, it is absolutely possible to ensure their voice is heard, and particularly with the UNCRC receiving royal assent, and the right of a voice and access to education will be supportive in this. But we've got systems like Talking Mats where we're able to support children to express what's challenging in school, what's going well, and what they would like to see in terms of their future. And we should absolutely be building that into to planning for improving these kids' outcomes.
Anyone? Irene?
So just to go back...
I was going to ask Irene to...
I agree that formal planning is really important, and it definitely should involve the parents and the young people. And the more successful plans that I've been involved with are the ones where everyone is really clear about what they're doing, what their role is, and there's regular revisiting of the plan, and there's honesty about what's working and what's not working, and you know, looking outwards to get more support when we need it, when things aren't working, from other professionals, and making sure that we're sharing the plans so that everyone's clear about what their role is.
Thank you. Stephanie, back to yourself, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. Just to pick up there on the fact that, you know, we've got quite a lot of different plans. We have the child's plan, we have coordinated support plans. Child's plans as well are called different things across different local authorities and stuff too. And I'm wondering if that in itself, just very specifically, the fact that different local authorities call plans different things, does that muddy the waters a bit, and is there a need to standardise that? Thanks.
Susie?
I'm going to kind of answer your question, Stephanie. I just want to say that I think for families and young people, the outcome is the most important thing, as opposed to necessarily the bit of paper or the document that it's written on. So I think, you know, we can be quite process driven, but actually the outcome is the most important thing. I think the point that was made earlier by Dina about the fact that child support plan is a legal document, it's important for families because it allows, you know, redress and recourse. So I think that that is really important, but it is a very complex landscape, and actually that's the case for not just for families and young people, but probably for professionals as well. But I just want to keep the focus on the outcome is the most important thing for the families and young people, and listening to them and hearing their voice and trusting their expertise. Again, as you say, Stephanie, it's extremely important.
Dina, do you want
so
to?
So it sounds like.
No, I was just going to add that the advocacy that you mentioned is an important part of that picture as well. Supporting the parents, supporting the child and the young person to make sure that they are equal partners in drawing up those plans. And those are the plans that Irene's referred to that I think have the most successful outcomes, because everyone's involved and they understand and they've agreed what the outcomes, the desired outcomes should be.
Thank you. Stephanie?
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, it sounds then like, if I'm picking this up right, that the formal plan's important, but quite often it's actually the less formal stuff that lies underneath that that actually drives forward the positive outcomes. I'm also interested as well in how policymakers and local authorities can ensure that there's equitable access to support for families and young people when there are disputes around the provision of additional support. And I know that even parents, for example, who work in local government or in inclusion themselves, can still struggle to access the supports that their child needs.
Who's looking? Dina, you were nodding. Can I bring yourself in there first, please?
Yeah, there is really limited resource for I suppose we're talking about redress, aren't we, for about accessing the support that you think that you're entitled to. Obviously, there are the formal routes through tribunals and so on, but that can be extremely daunting for families who are already struggling with their relationship with the local authority to then... I know the tribunal's not meant to be such a combative area as, you know, the courts, for example, but nevertheless, often local authorities are supported by legal teams, whereas it's very difficult for families to find legal representation, skilled legal representation that can take them into the tribunals. So I do think there should be much more accessible routes for families to challenge where they're not getting the support, where the child is not thriving. And I'm not quite sure what that would look like, but I think it does have to be easier for families to understand the processes and how to speak to the local authorities about the provision that they're receiving or not receiving.
Thanks, Tina. Susie Martin now, please.
Yeah, I guess I just want to reiterate the point I made right at the start, that we do find that we hear from every day from families who are really fighting the system and fighting tooth and nail for the support that they need. And it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be that redress is so difficult to access. It should be much easier to access for families, for children and young people. And that's what I think Dina is really referring to. And it is a very daunting task for families to have to go to a tribunal and seek redress, you know, through that route. Something, it shouldn't be getting that far in the first place, I think, is the point. So it's, you know, what comes before that, what's happening before that, that families are not getting, that maybe we need to put in place so they don't feel like they have to go all the way to that tribunal or take legal action.
Mm-hmm. Deborah's keen to come in here too. Thanks.
Yeah, just following on from that financial barrier for people to access that legal representation. We see many families where they are, you know, eligible to legal aid and they can follow that course. But those in the middle on just a modest income can't afford. And it was reported to us, I think, recently for a parent wanting to challenge a placement request refusal that it would cost them £4,000 to do so. And they didn't have that money. So people are locked out of, you know, being able to legally take things forward. It would be really good if there was some access to free legal representation when there are these school placement refusals and disability discrimination. And as it's been said, nobody wants to take that route, but sometimes that's all that's left for you to fight to get your child or young person's what's needed. And unfortunately, as a parent, I had to do that myself, and it was one of the most distressing journeys.
Thank you. Stephanie?
I think that's a really important point, convener, on legal representation. But just to go back for a moment to what Susie said there about, you know, the support should already be in place so that we're not getting to that stage. But unfortunately, there will still be occasions, I'm sure, when we do come to that stage. So I'm wondering, how is it we actually bring the information together and make it easier for people to access? Is it about bringing everything together on a website that's easily accessible to parents, or what are Susie's suggestions around that point she made?
Thank you. I think you're right. It was really interesting, actually, the survey that we put out specifically for this inquiry. There was actually quite a high level of awareness of the, you know, access to advocacy, mediation, adjudication that, you know, parents and young people have a right to in legislation. However, that's a self-selecting group of people that have responded to that survey who probably have a very keen interest in this area and have potentially accessed that themselves. So, you know, I think certainly, you know, within the autism community, there maybe is quite a bit of awareness of some of those options, but there are a lot of families out there who will not know that they have those rights, will not, you know, have the financial resource to fight the system. I'm not necessarily sure a website is the way to go. I think, you know, certainly having all the information in one place is no bad thing, but I don't think that necessarily provides the solution about, you know, ensuring that parents and young people are aware of their rights. There's probably something that should be done in schools, that schools can do to ensure that families and young people are aware of their rights within legislation. I don't think there's necessarily an easy answer to that, though. But certainly, we want more families to know what their rights are within legislation, as well as, you know, let's try not get to that point, but we do need those legal protections in place.
Do any other panel members want to come in before I move to Ross Greer? Irene?
I was going to say, I mean, Enquire already has a really good website, and they are a really good source of advice and support for families and also for professionals. But I'm always amazed that, you know, even though you've got leaflets in school and you're telling parents about that, there's still parents who are oblivious to the support that's out there from Enquire.
And I know that next week we're moving on to actually hearing from the tribunal element of this, so that we can really dig under the surface of that then. Is everything all covered there, Stephanie? Can I move to Ben? It's actually Ben McPherson that's coming in now.
If I could just pick up really briefly, Convener, on the last point that was made there about Enquire. I think possibly, you know, that's one of the things around advocacy, is the fact that there's so much information out there, and what parents actually need is to be directed to the information that's actually most relevant to them and their child.
Thank you very much. Okay, Ben McPherson, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Two last questions that are on slightly different areas than we've covered already. The first is, we've talked all about schooling today, and I just wondered if there was anything you wanted to emphasise to us about the experiences of young people in further and higher education or in apprenticeship programmes. And also related to what we've discussed already, a large majority of the casework I get is on the housing crisis, and a lot of the constituents I try to assist have children who require additional support needs and are in temporary accommodation. And I just wondered if there was anything you wanted to emphasise about the effect of the housing crisis on the young people that you support.
Dina and then Irene, please. Thanks.
Just on the further education, higher education and apprenticeship. We've just taken a look at apprenticeships in Scotland because we were trying to trace the pathway of neurodivergent young people post-school. And what we found actually was that there wasn't very good data. We had a quantitative methods student embedded with us who was going to interrogate the data to let us see what those journeys looked like for those young people, but actually the data's collected rather inconsistently across the different types of apprenticeships, but also Skills Development Scotland advised that although they did have some data around neurodiversity, it was a very small data set which they weren't at liberty to share with us because of that. And so really all we could see was disability more generally described. And it's clear that actually the people that are most disadvantaged going through the apprenticeship system would appear to be care experienced young people, followed by people who have a disability. But one of our findings was that the apprenticeships that we thought that school pupils ought to be able to take advantage of were incredibly patchy across the country. Some schools had nothing to offer the pupils. Others had quite a range of apprenticeship that they could suggest might be a good next step for them. So we have a report on that, which I can share with the committee.
Please.
I've got Irene's indicated, and then Glenn, if that's okay. Thank you.
I'm kind of echoing what Diana's just said about the lack of opportunities for children with additional support needs is patchy across Scotland. It's really difficult to find apprenticeships and college programmes and, you know, for further education, especially for young people who want to leave school at 16. And for some young people, it is the right move for them to move on, but it's finding the right thing for them. And if we're listening to the pupil voice and they are very clearly saying they don't want to be in school for fifth and sixth year, they want to do something else, and there's nothing out there for them that guidance teachers, that you know, work coaches and things can find, then it's really challenging.
Glenn.
Thanks, Ben. I think your question points to future outcomes for these young people, and you know the research is really clear. We've got 88% of young unemployed men with communication needs. We've got 60% of young people in contact with the justice with communication needs, and they will struggle to access some of the services like housing and further education unless we do the preventative work. And it feels like there's not a lot of hope out there. I actually wrote an article recently called The Language of Hope. And the reason I did that was because, yes, it's hard working in the public sector, it's hard meeting needs, but when it comes to communication needs, it's one area that's most amenable to change if we get in as early as possible, and it has such powerful impacts on these future, the life of these young people, that we can't ignore it. But we're at this tipping point where I'm concerned that unless we take action with the reducing resources, speech language therapy, the lack of supply, that we're going to see this impact for the next generation and generations to come.
Susie.
Yeah, just very quickly, I wanted to touch on, the links actually back to education in the mainstream setting at primary and secondary age, in that education is a fundamental human right and all children, young people should be receiving an education. That right is being routinely violated in Scotland for children and young people who have additional support for learning needs, in particular autistic children and young people, and that affects their future life prospects. We see it affects their ability to move into higher or further education, into employment, which then has a knock-on impact for all sorts of aspects of their lives, their personal lives, housing, contact with the justice system, whatever it may be. So this is a really important issue, and it's really important that we get support in that mainstream setting right. In terms of support in further and higher education, we actually provide support for autistic students at five universities, I believe it is five, across Scotland, and that's funded by a government fund. So we're doing a bit of that work, and actually we find that we do work sometimes with colleges as well. There, we have a team, an employability team, that work with young people who are potentially going to college or university, and we work with those colleges and universities. We find that colleges are quite good at putting adaptations and support in place. Often that they're a bit better at that than sometimes some universities. But yeah, there's a lack of consistency. It's inconsistent across the country, and it very much requires us to be working with the young person a lot of the time for that support to be put in place.
And deputies don't provide their own support?
I'm sure some universities do. We obviously provide a specific service that's funded by a specific government fund, but I'm sure there are universities that are putting their own support in place. Yeah. And often we do work one-to-one with a young person who's going to a specific university or college, and we'll work with that university or college to put support in place for that student.
Thanks for correcting me.
Sorry, Deborah's wanting in on this as well, Ben. So Ben McPherson, sorry. Deborah Best.
Thanks. I'll just be quick. So again, looking at training, in relation to apprenticeships, really important that any young apprenticeship they go into, that organisation has the training around their neurodiversity to be able to support them. And in relation to the wider access programme for, those coming from deprived areas, care experience background, potentially could that be extended to neurodivergent students that really struggle to attain to the level of their ability within the secondary school environment, and they, quite often don't have the qualifications that they should come out with, and are losing opportunities within that further education environment.
Thank you, Deborah.
Thank you. Nobody wanted to touch on the impact of
housing,
temporary accommodation, and
I don't know if this panel is particularly.
If that's not appropriate, I'll withdraw. Yeah. And thank you for all your.
Or Deborah, do you want to comment on that briefly?
I was just going to very quickly. We have a parent who has a young man undiagnosed that was in a supported accommodation, and he lost that tenancy and became homeless. So extremely sad story. Again, I think the lack of diagnosis hasn't helped, because no one really kind of is understanding his challenges.
Here we go. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
And thanks, everyone. I'd like to thank our panel and witnesses for their evidence this morning. We plan to take further evidence on this inquiry at our meetings in March. We will then produce a report based on what we have heard with recommendations for the Scottish Government. And this concludes the public part of our proceedings. And then I suspend the meeting to allow our witnesses to leave. And the committee will then move into private session to consider the final agenda item. So I'll suspend for 10 minutes and then we will move. OK, thank you very much.